decided that this might be the most important topic we've covered yet when it comes to surviving in the wild: building emergency survival shelters. Now, there are dozens of shelters being shown on YouTube right now, many operating under the title of survival shelter, and many are pretty spectacular. But they also took several hours, even days sometimes, to build. It might qualify a little bit more as living shelters or long-term shelters. And when we've used the term survival shelter in the past, we've always been talking about something just a bit different, which is quick emergency survival shelters that can be easily constructed and ensure our survival while it's being immediately threatened by the circumstances around us. Now, there's of course a time and a place for a variety of different shelters, but we decided that definitions matter here, and so we refer to our shelters now as emergency survival shelters. So there's a clear distinction being made between what we're going to show you and the other types of survival shelters you might see. So why does any of that matter? Well, because in a true survival situation where someone's actual survival is being threatened and they set out to build a survival shelter, we wouldn't want them thinking that they needed to spend several hours building an elaborate structure like they saw on TV just to survive the night. In fact, that decision could ironically be a decision that puts their own survival in jeopardy. So we want to show you how to construct these quick, simple little shelters which have quite literally preserved our own survival in more than one emergency situation. So we know for a fact that they work, because we're here right now teaching you how to make them. Now let's get to the details. The first thing we're going to do is decide which version of emergency shelter to make. And in this case, we're going to prepare for a night of cold and rain. Even though we know a fire is ideal, we're going to show you how to get so warm you won't even need a fire, which means the key here is going to be your own body heat. So we don't want one of these big roomy shelters. We want to get ourselves tucked in tight with thick insulation all around us. So if we come across a giant downed evergreen like this, we know that nature has already built most of our shelter for us, and we just need to burrow a cozy den by doing a little digging and insulating before we get all tucked in tight for the night. Hypothermia would certainly be a risk in temperatures like this that hover right around freezing, especially if snow or rain is expected. So we need to make sure we're covered and insulated. Squirrels, chipmunks, birds, and many other wild animals know how to make nests and dens to stay insulated and warm, even in bitter cold conditions, and we've been fortunate enough to learn how to do it too. So let's get to it. So now that we got a plan, we're going to spend the highest percentage of our time and energy collecting the insulating materials first. See, we already know it won't take us long to dig out our den under the log, but we don't want to be scrambling around the forest in the dark trying to collect insulation, running the risk of not having enough. There is nothing more important with these types of shelters than having adequate quantity of insulation, because it's going to be fully surrounding us on all sides. And because these shelters are intentionally not elaborate, we can focus our attention on collecting the insulation without having to worry about time and energy going into construction when we get back to our site. Sword fern is one of the greatest survival plants in the world. And without a doubt, that's our first priority, gathering huge amounts of it. First of all, it's very water resistant and quick drying. It also typically grows in great quantities. It's very easy to harvest. And most importantly, it makes an incredible insulator. We'll show you when we get back to our site how we use it, because there is a specific order we use when we stuff it in our den and combine it with our next insulator, which is dry moss. Now, it's important to point out that sword fern is capable of doing this job alone. It's that good. But if you have access to dry moss, you can't pass it up. Not only does it insulate, but it's just so soft and comfortable. It won't be water resistant like the sword fern, but it is an amazing insulator, perfect for trapping in body heat and creating a barrier between us and the cold. You would be amazed, if you've never done it, how quickly your core temperature goes up just from stuffing moss inside your clothing. We found that you can collect it in bigger chunks by peeling it off of the tree bark, but in many cases, it's just hanging right off the tree limbs as well, or even growing along the ground. Now, with the sword fern and the moss collected, we've basically got everything we need. But how can we possibly pass up the opportunity to take these long strips of bark from this fallen cedar? We probably don't need it for this first den shelter we're doing, but we're taking it anyway, because it is so valuable for shelters, and for sure we'll find a good use for it in a future shelter project, which we'll show you. Okay, back at our shelter site, it's time to prep our little den. First, we'll get the obvious debris out of our way so we can have some room to work. Once that's done, it's simply a matter of digging out a hole for ourselves under this log like some kind of wild animal. We're careful, though, to not build up a slant that would run water down into our den. Most of the top layer can be scraped away with our arms, our hands, and feet, but once we get down to that harder dirt, it is crucial to have a couple of digging sticks, which we simply cut out with our knife. These digging sticks are made from fine maple. Now, this is an important point here. How do we know how far back to dig under the log? Well, you can't necessarily trust the edge of the log as the drip line because water loves to round corners and could possibly come and find us during the night. Well, all you really need to do is find the very clear line on the ground that separates the moist dirt from the bone dry dirt. This handful of dry dirt has not seen moisture for many, many decades, so I know if I get myself back at least that far, I'm good to go. Even though this shelter won't require cordage, these cedar roots are going to be a luxury later on when we construct different types of shelters. Plus, you never know exactly what could happen, and it's always a comfort to know you've got tying material handy. We do a couple of checks for length. We don't want this den to be any longer than needed. Again, we want to be tucked in tight, but with enough space for lots of insulation. So as far as length goes, we're only going to go long enough to sleep in a curled up side position. A quick log and fern roof to divert water was actually not needed for this den since we already showed you where the drip line was, but we threw it on just for demonstration purpose in case you need to divert the rain. Now we're going to start laying the insulation. We start with sword ferns and lots of it. We want a barrier between us and the ground, not just for comfort, but to insulate us from the cold. Also, let's say the ground was a bit moist. These ferns make a sufficient barrier between us and the moisture. The next layer is the moss. This stuff is so comfortable to lay on, but more importantly, it's going to trap our body heat in and keep us warm all night. The next layer of fern, we're going to pile up big and set a bit off to the side so that we have room to roll into our den. This will block the outside cold air from coming in and trap in place our warm air. I like to go with the big hug and roll method for entry, but you could also crawl in and cinch the pile in towards you with a stick and some cordage, but rolling is so much more fun. The temperature when we filmed this was right around freezing, and it didn't take long in this den before I was comfortably warm, and even too warm. But hey, a little too warm isn't going to threaten my survival like the cold is, so no complaints here. Emergency shelters do not try to impress. They do not look spectacular. They are not elaborate by design. They also don't take all day to build or drain your time and energy, but they will save your life. We know that from experience. Now, of course, we need to be experienced with several types of shelters, just like we should be experienced building several types of fires. And we can't wait to show you the rest of our shelter models we use. Make sure you're subscribed with the notifications on, and we'll see you in the next one.